morning. Welcome to Sunday morning at First United Methodist Church. My name is Keith and I'm the senior pastor. And I just want to say thanks to all of you for tuning in. These are difficult times with all of this, but it's been kind of fun and exciting to see ways that we can connect together online. And so I really do hope that you all are doing well and look forward to our time together now. I want to remind you just to participate with all of the stuff that comes across the YouTube channel. So if you want to get your Bibles and read along as we read, sing along as a family or as an individual. The nice thing about singing in your home is you can just sing really loud. I know some of you might be meeting in smaller groups. I don't know if you'll still be doing that this week. But if there are safe ways to connect and worship together, that would be fantastic. But please be safe with that. In a little while, there'll be the offertory, the time for offering. And again, I just want to thank all of you for the ways that you are giving, and just ask you to continue to do so. At that time, there will be information on the screen on how you can give. So thanks for that. And we'd love to know how it's going. We've got lots of pictures and notes and things from you all about your experiences with all of this, and it encourages us. It helps us to know that the time we're putting into it is really worth it, and so we love that too. So anyway, thanks again for being here, and let's just start our time together with prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the gift of a new day, and again, we're in this strange place where we're isolated, necessarily isolated. We pray that you would keep us all safe in our homes and the places where we are, that you would hold us and keep us with your Holy Spirit, and that through this internet connection, we can somehow feel a sense of togetherness, and not just on Sundays, but through the week too. Help us to reach out safely to people that we know who need to be touched in some way. Help us to continue to be your church. Let this time of worship that we're about to experience empower us and inspire us and unite us together as your church. And we thank you for all these things in the name of Christ. Amen.
Oh, as an affirmation of faith. This affirmation of faith is something the confirmation class last year wrote all together as a class. And we have one of our confirmants from last year, Hudson Blackburn, here to lead us in it.
So will you please read the affirmation? We believe God's love is powerful. So powerful nobody can fully understand how much God loves us and forgives us. We believe Jesus died for our salvation so we can experience his never-ending love and forgiveness. We believe the Holy Spirit is mysterious and sometimes hard to understand and always with us. It protects us, guides us, and speaks the truth to us. We believe human beings are not perfect, but no one is a mistake. Even though we all make mistakes, we will always be loved and forgiven. We believe the Bible is an outline by which to live our lives. It is God's Word, the gift to us. The Bible contains truth, and it helps us find the path of peace. We believe that in the church, we are all welcome, and we are all a family. We are kind to each other, and we are safe. We believe that as disciples, God will always be there for us and give us strength.
Join us for the scripture reading on Exodus 25, verses 1 through 9. The Lord said to Moses, "Tell the Israelites to take for me an offering. From all whose hearts prompt them to give, you shall receive the offering for me. This is the offering that you shall receive from them: gold, silver, and bronze, blue, purple, and crimson yarn, and fine linen, goat's hair, tanned ram skin, fine leather, acacia wood, oil for the lamps, spices for the anointing oil, and for the fragrant incense, onyx stones and gems to be set in the ephod, and for the breastpiece. And have them make me a sanctuary, so I may dwell among them, in accordance with all that I show you concerning the pattern of the tabernacle and of its furniture. You shall make it."
I am sad you're not with me this morning, but I am so glad that we can be together through technology and phones and cameras. I found this little Jesus on my desk and I really like him, and it made me start thinking about things right now while we're apart. So usually on Sundays, we come to church and Jesus meets us there and we hear praise music. Well, we can still do all that. And what we need to remember is that church is anywhere people are gathered and calling out Jesus' name. I was thinking, I bet even on the ark, God was there. Noah and his family were on the ark and they were praying and singing and calling God in, and that was their church. So while we're all apart and we're not having school and we are at home watching videos and doing our schoolwork, we can still worship on Sunday and in our house during the week. We can call Jesus in and pray together and talk about him and watch church on TV. How crazy is that? No matter where we are, Jesus is there if we call his name and worship him. Let's close in prayer. Dear Jesus, thank you that we don't have to be in church to call your name. We can worship and have a church wherever you are there and we are worshiping you. It's in your precious name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. I hope you're all doing well, no matter where you are. I want to start by just saying how much I miss you, how much we all here on staff miss seeing all of you that come in here throughout the week, and especially on Sunday mornings for our Sundays of worship. I hope you're doing well. I hope you're finding some light this morning. This has been such a unique time that I don't think any of us could have possibly anticipated. And when the pastor asked me to preach on March 22nd, a couple months ago, I certainly didn't know that this is what it would look like. And when I decided that I wanted to use the first few verses from the 25th chapter of Exodus, I certainly had no idea how meaningful those words would be to me under the present circumstances. I've actually gotten a great deal of hope this week as I've thought about what I'm going to say to you. I like to work at night, so I'll come over here in the evenings and I'll read and I'll study and I'll walk up and down the halls. And this week, as I've walked up and down some dark and empty halls, I've just been filled with so many beautiful memories of all the ministry and all the love and all the worship that we've experienced here at First United Methodist Church. And so when I read those words that Nicole just read for us about how Moses went up on top of Mount Sinai and met with God, and God said, "Tell the Israelites, tell my people to build a sanctuary," I'm really inspired by that. And I think to myself, how do we build our sanctuaries today? How do we build a sanctuary here at First Methodist Church? You know, we don't have gold and silver and bronze and acacia wood. We don't have fine gemstones. We know that's not really what we build a sanctuary with. And so I've walked up and down these halls and in and out of some classrooms, and I was reminded that we have some very special things that we use to build sanctuaries with in the Methodist Church. And we say it every time that we have a new member join or that we have a baptism. We're going to say it really soon for a confirmation class that's been hard at work this year. We all say together, and I bet you know these words and you can say them with me, that we renew our covenant to faithfully participate in the church and in its ministries with our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. I think that's how we really build a sanctuary. So, since we can be pretty mobile this morning with our sermon, Nick and I are going to walk around to some of these places where we always have seen the prayers and presence and gifts and service and witness of First United Methodist Church in real and tangible ways. And so we invite you to come with us. Prayer is such an important part of what it means to be a Christian and what it means to build a church. And every Sunday morning for me begins in this room. This is Keith's office. This is the senior pastor's office. And if you've never been in here, you should come check it out sometime. Keith loves to have visitors. He'll make you a cup of coffee. And he'll, you know, sit down and get to know you. This is a really friendly room. We use this for so many things now, including on Sunday morning, the Centering Prayer Group meets here. But before all that on Sunday morning, Pastors Keith and Becky and myself, we gather in this room and we join hands. And sometimes we might be a little nervous about something that's going on that day. Sometimes we might be a little tired, you know, from daylight savings or something like that. But we always join hands and we say a prayer. We say a prayer for the entire church that's gathering to worship that morning. We say a prayer that the Spirit of God will move through this place. But more than that, how many times have I seen someone walk into the church? Sometimes I know who it is, sometimes I don't. And they ask us, they say, is there a pastor here? Is there someone who will pray with me? And they come into this room and they join in prayer. And then, you know, I've also sat in these chairs sometimes with families who have just lost a loved one. And we're sitting here, you know, to plan a funeral service, but we always find ourselves holding hands and praying, asking God to let a little light shine in our lives, a little light around the corners of our sadness. So to me, this is not really an office at all. This is a sanctuary where people come to pray. All right, so I'm sitting up here on the third floor of our church in one of our Sunday school rooms. And this is one of the many places that makes me think about how present our church is for each other. This is specifically the SALT classroom. A few weeks ago, we had a couple joined the church at 11 o'clock, the Fishers, and it was so awesome. The Fishers came down to the front to meet with Keith and Becky, and I think Becky invited any friends and family who wanted to come stand with them, and the entire SALT class left their pews, more than 30 of them it seemed, and they walked down to the front and stood with the Fishers as they joined the church and as they entered into a covenant with us here at First United Methodist Church and us with them. And I know that that same spirit runs through all of our Sunday schools, all of our small groups, many of the classes that meet in the middle of the week. I know it's a big part of what the choir is about, being present for each other. And I think one of the ways that we show that the best is not just in how we show up for other people when they need us, but how much we miss them when we are absent. I know that in this Sunday school class and in all those other places I just mentioned, when someone is gone, when someone is sick, I know that they are missed. And I think that's one of the best ways that we show our presence to other people, by letting them know how much we miss them. That might be a good thing for us to do as a church right now, to think of someone who we could call or write a letter to and just let them know how much we miss them. So this is one of my favorite rooms in the church. And whenever I think about gifts and the kind of gifts that this church gives to the world, this room comes to mind, because every morning, Monday through Friday at 8 a.m., kids sit in a circle in this room and they sing that every single day is a gift, that every single day is a gift from God. And so would you sing that song with me? That song that the kids sing as a blessing onto our world every morning of the week. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. I think it'd be good if we sang that every morning.
When I think about service and the way this church serves the community, I think about this room. I'm standing here in the gym and, you know, we are constantly having events that serve the community in this room. We probably average more than a meal every single week, either for our church on Wonderful Wednesday or our community meals. You know, we talk about Pancake Day a lot. We just celebrated Pancake Day about a month ago. But, you know, there's some things that are pretty unique about Pancake Day. This year, my father drove down from Winston-Salem. It was his first time ever coming to a Pancake Day, and he remarked how impressed he was the level of service. He came in, he didn't have a ticket, but that didn't matter. He came in, he went through the line and got his pancakes and his sausage, and then he went to sit at a table. And immediately, a person from the church came up to him and said, "What would you like to drink? Do you want coffee? We got that. You want milk? We got that too." Pancake Day is all about service. And I know we talk about it a lot. But, you know, there's some parts about Pancake Day that maybe you're not familiar with. Did you know that 30 years ago, when we were designing this space, this gymnasium, that would one day become a sanctuary for our church every Sunday morning, someone had the foresight to ask the architects to put in their designs four evenly spaced floor outlets. And these are heavy-duty floor outlets that we can plug our griddles into on Pancake Day. And I just think that's amazing that someone would go to that much trouble just so that this church could serve the community a little better on one very special day of the year. Man, whoever came up with that idea sure knew how to build a sanctuary. You know, as I walked around this church thinking about our witness to each other and to the community, I was aware that there's not one room that really stands out over any other. People of this church are so eager to share their stories and to share their lives with other people. But when I came down to this room, and this is our youth chapel, it's set up like a theater, and I was just aware of how strong a witness takes place in this room every Sunday night. You see, on Sunday nights, youth come in here and they sit down with each other and they take that risk, and I think it is a risk, to open up their lives with each other, to share a little bit of their self with their neighbor. They risk a little bit more faith as individuals and as a community. And around this time of year, something really amazing happens. Every Sunday night, one of our older students, usually a senior in high school, will prepare what's called a youth talk. And he or she will stand up in front of the rest of the group and share their story, share their testimony, bear witness to what God has done in their life. And I think the real power of witness, the real power that comes when we share ourselves with other people, is that we give them the courage and the confidence to one day stand up and share their story with people as well. All right, well, we've finally made it to this sanctuary. And I'm thinking this morning that this may not even be the most significant sanctuary in our lives. After all, right now, no one's in this room. This space is empty. In fact, all those rooms that we've been to are empty right now this morning. There's no prayers,
being made in the pastor's office. There's no songs being sung down in the CDC. There's no meals getting ready in the gymnasium. The youth aren't going to be meeting tonight at the youth chapel. And our Sunday school classes are spread out all over the place right now, it feels. But you know, I know that even though these rooms are empty, I know that there are still prayers being made. I know that there are still songs being sung. I know that people are finding new and unique ways to connect with each other, new ways to serve each other. I know that this congregation is finding a new life of presence with each other and presence with God. And I think it's important to remember that when God told Moses and the Israelites to build a sanctuary, a place where he could dwell, God didn't say, build a big room. God didn't say, get some bricks and some mortar. You know what the original tabernacle was? It was a tent. God's home on earth was the kind of place that you could pick up and take with you. I think that's an amazing thing for us to remember in these days. So I want you to look around in your life right now. I want you to see what you find. You might find a prayer that you can offer. You might find a song that you can sing. You might be able to help a neighbor out, to lend a helping hand. No matter what form or shape it comes in, take those gifts of the heart and give them back to God. Because God is still talking to us today. God is still asking us to build him a sanctuary where God can live and move and breathe within us. Let us sing this song together.
Today, I would like for you to join me on Wednesday or join one of the pastors on Wednesdays. We're going to be doing again our live prayer time. We did that this week and it was really well attended. Over 100 people came into it to join me, and I had text messages with prayer concerns live, and it really did feel like we were together. It felt like I could have that conversation with you all and share your prayer concerns. So please join us on Wednesdays at noon on Facebook Live and also on YouTube. And you'll be getting emails about how to do that, but love to have you with us. It was a really meaningful time. And so as we go to God in prayer today, I ask you just to take a moment of silence and lift up those prayer concerns in the rooms in which you're gathered. to join us for worship today. We want you to have an opportunity to list those things out loud as a family or into your space by yourself, and know that God hears your prayers. So let us go to God in prayer together. Holy God, we give you thanks for moments of grace. And even though these times are difficult and these times are strange and these places in which we walk are uncharted territory, we give you thanks for reminders that you are among us, for surprising us with your love, for surprising us with hope and joy in places we never thought imaginable. We give you thanks for the ways in which we have worked together as a church over these past few days to extend love, to extend care, and to remind ourselves that we as the church are forever the body of Christ, and nothing can separate us from that. We give you thanks also for the many ways in which our community in Haywood County and communities across our nation are pooling together, are finding ways to support one another, to care for each other, to extend kindness and love. We also give you thanks that the ways in which we worship you are not confined to specific places in which we feel at home and know that we gather in those spaces to worship you. Because we've seen this past Sunday how our living rooms or our bedrooms became holy places, holy ground in which we come to worship you. And there are so many other places to come together in worship, to lift up your name, to welcome your presence, to acknowledge the power that you give to us and that light of Christ that shines. We pray that as we continue throughout these next days and weeks, whatever that might look like, we pray that you would continue to walk alongside of us, carrying our burdens, bringing us friends along the way to lift us up. We lift up to you today the concerns that we mentioned in our prayer time this past Wednesday, and also the prayer concerns that we have lifted up today, for there are so many. We give you thanks that the place to go with those concerns is at your feet. Remove anxiety from our minds and our hearts. Still them and quiet them. Help us to live as freed people, not people who are bogged down by fear. Help us to cling to the truths that we know of, that our faith tells us, that you tell us, that you are strong, that you are in control, that you are big, and that you are taking care of us all the time. We ask that you continue to show us those glimmers of hope and help us to find new ways to reach out to those around us by giving people a phone call that we haven't talked to in a while, or considering those people who usually sit next to us and wondering how they're doing. Go that next step and pick up the phone and call them. By reaching out to those that we love, we're finding new ways to knit our community together. So let us do that. Encourage us to continue to build those connections with one another. We ask all of this in your name as we pray together the Lord's Prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
And so now, wherever you are, take this benediction. Rejoice in the Lord always. Don't be anxious for anything, but make your prayers and your supplications and give them to God. And the peace of God that passes all understanding will be ours.